In order to better understand the role of each of the beta control signals, we will work through an example problem that provides us with a partially filled control table for five different instructions. Two of these instructions are existing beta instructions that we must infer from the provided control signals. The other three are three new instructions that we are adding to our beta by modifying the necessary control signals to produce the desired behavior of each of the operations. The first instruction that we want to add to our beta is an LDX instruction, which is a load that is double indexed. What this means is that in order to produce the effective address of the load, instead of adding the contents of a register to a constant as is done in the load instruction, we add the contents of two different registers. So the address for this load operation is the result of adding together the contents of registers RA and RB. The contents of the memory location pointed to by this effective address are loaded into register RC. Finally, the PC is incremented by 4 to point to the next instruction. The second instruction that we want to add to our beta is a move ZC instruction, which is a move constant if 0 instruction. The way this instruction works is that if the contents of register RA equals 0, then the sign extended version of the literal constant will be loaded into register RC. This is followed by incrementing the PC to point to the next instruction. The third instruction that we want to add to our beta is a STR instruction, which is a store relative instruction. For this instruction, the effective address is computed by sign extending the constant C, multiplying it by 4, and adding it to PC plus 4. The contents of register RC are then stored at the memory location pointed to by the effective address that was just computed. As a final step, the PC is incremented by 4 to point to the next instruction. We are given the partially filled control ROM shown here. It is our job to fill in all the yellow boxes labeled with a question mark. Let's begin by looking at the top row of this table. The value that stands out as a bit different in this row is the PC cell value, which is equal to 2. For most instructions, PC cell equals 0. For branch instructions, it equals 1. And for jump instructions, it equals 2. This means that the instruction described in this row must be a jump instruction. Zooming in on the PC cell control logic from the beta diagram, we see that normally PC cell equals 0 to go to the next instruction. PC cell equals 1 in order to perform a branch operation, and PC cell equals 2 in order to perform a jump operation where the target of the jump is specified by JT, or the jump target. This means that the instruction described in this row must be a jump instruction. The behavior of a jump instruction is shown here. The effective address is calculated by taking the contents of RA and clearing the bottom two bits so that the value becomes word aligned. The address of the next instruction, which is PC plus 4, is stored in register RC in case we need to return to the next instruction in the program. The PC is then updated with a new effective address in order to actually continue execution at the destination of the jump instruction. This data flow diagram highlights the required data flow through the beta in order to properly implement the jump instruction. Note that no red lines pass through the ALU or memory because the ALU and memory are not used for this instruction. The control signals that must be set in order to follow this path in the beta are as follows. WDCell, or Write Data Select, must be set to 0 in order to pass the value of PC plus 4 through the WDCell MUX. WRF, or Write Enable Register File, must be set to 1 in order to enable writing to the register file. WACell, or Write Address Select, must be set to 0 in order to write to the RC register and not to the XP register. ACell, BCell, and ALUFN are all don't cares for the jump instruction. In addition, MOE, which stands for Memory Output Enable, is also a don't care because this instruction does not use the memory data. The one control signal related to the memory that we do need to worry about is the MWR, or memory write-read signal, which must be set to 0 so that no value will be written to memory. Going back to our control ROM and filling in the value of WRF, we see that the control signals for the jump instruction correspond to the data flow diagram of the beta that we just looked at. Moving on to row 2 of our control ROM, we see that now we have PC cell equal to Z in this row. This suggests that the instruction corresponding to this row is some kind of a branch instruction. Of our two branch instructions, the one that branches when Z equals 1 is BEQ. This means that this row corresponds to a BEQ operation. The rest of the control signals for the BEQ operation look just like the ones for the jump, because here too the ALU and memory are not used, so the only ALU and memory related signal that must be set is MWR, so we don't write to memory. Furthermore, like the jump instruction, the branch instructions also store the return address in register RC, so the behavior of the control signals related to the register file are all the same. We now take a look at the third row of the control ROM. In this row, we are actually told that the corresponding instruction is the newly added LDX instruction. So it is our job to determine how to set the missing control signals in order to get the desired behavior for this operation. Recall that the expected behavior of this instruction is that the contents of register RA and RB will be added together in order to produce the effective address of the load. This means that we need to perform an add as our ALUFN. We also need A cell and B cell equal to 0 in order to pass the values of registers RA and RB to the ALU. The complete data flow through the register file ALU and memory is shown here. In order to read register RB rather than RC, RA2 cell must be set to 0. As we just mentioned, A cell and B cell are set to 0 and ALUFN is set to add. The result of adding registers RA and RB is used as the address of the load. This is called MA, or memory address in the beta diagram. In order to enable reading from memory, we set MWR to 0 and MOE to 1. This sets the read-write functionality to read and enables an output to be read from the read port of the memory. On the beta diagram, the read data is labeled MRD, or memory read data. The data that is read from memory is then passed along to the register file by setting WD cell equal to 2. In order to write this result to register RC, WRF equals 1 and WA cell equals 0. So the completed control ROM for the LDX operation is shown here. We now move on to the fourth instruction. Here we see that ALUFN just passes operand B through the register file. We also see that WRF is dependent on the value of Z. This means that the instruction that corresponds to this row is move ZC, which moves a constant into register RC if the contents of register RA equals 0. The way this instruction works is that B cell equals 1 in order to pass the constant through as the B operand, and ALUFN equals B to pass that constant through the ALU. WD cell equals 1 so that the output of the ALU is fed back as the write value for the register file. Because WD cell equals 1 and not 2, we know that the data coming out of the memory will be ignored, so MOE can be a don't care. Of course, MWR still must be set to 0 in order to ensure that we don't write any random values into our memory. RA2 cell is also a don't care because we don't care whether register RB or register RC are passed through as the second read argument of the register file, RD2. The reason we don't care is because the B cell equal to 1 will ignore the RD2 value and pass through the constant that comes directly from the instruction after sign extending it. A cell is also a don't care because the ALU will ignore the A input when ALUFN equals B. WA cell must be 0 so that the result of the operation is written into register RC. Finally, PC cell equals 0 to load PC plus 4 into the PC register so that the next instruction will get fetched after this one. We are now on the last row of our control ROM. We know that this row must correspond to our third added instruction, which is STR, or store relative. Recall that this instruction writes the contents of register RC into memory at the address that is computed by the effective address line. The effective address for this instruction is PC plus 4 plus 4 times the sign extended constant. The extra adder just under the instruction memory is used to calculate PC plus 4 plus 4 times the sign extended constant. This value is then fed to the ALU via the A operand by setting A cell equal to 1. Setting ALUFN equal to A passes this value as the output of the ALU in order to be used as the memory address. This is the address that the store will write to in memory. The value that will be written to this address in memory is the contents of register RC. Register RC is fed through the register file by setting RA2 cell equal to 1. This makes RD2 have the contents of register RC. This value then becomes the MWD, or memory write data, which is the data that will be stored in the memory address that was produced by the ALU. In order to enable writing to the memory, MWR must be set to 1. Since WRF equals 0, nothing can be written to the register file. This means that the value of MA cell and MD cell are don't cares, since the register file won't be affected regardless of their values. Finally, the PC is incremented by 4 to fetch the next instruction. So our completed control ROM for the STR operation is shown here.